रवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः.
We'll begin with this poem, The Mountain and the Squirrel.
The mountain and the squirrel. The mountain and the squirrel had a quarrel, and the former called the latter little prig. Bun replied, "You are doubtless very big, but all sorts of things and weather must be taken in together to make up a year and a sphere. And I think it no disgrace to occupy my place. If I am not so large as you are not so small as I, and not half so spry. I'll not deny you make a very pretty squirrel track. Talents differ. All is well and wisely put. If I cannot carry forests on my back, neither can you crack a nut." Ralph Waldo Emerson.
A very small but a very effective poem, very simple in its narrative and its message, but a very deep message. See, the life as such presents us a picture of contradictions. They are not real contradictions but apparent contradictions. Contradiction is because it appears to be not normal from our limited perspective, but the grand scheme of things we are not able to understand and our intellect is limited. So one has to only understand, or one has to be just aware of this beautiful scheme of things that is functioning in this universe and stand aghast. If you look at the way that any, let's say, how any university in this world is composed of in terms of the students who pursue particular subjects in the university, it follows a sort of a pyramidal structure. You can take arbitrarily any university across any city in the world, whether it be India, Japan or America. You will find that as the subjects become subtler, the number of takers, the number of students who are studying there, automatically that reduces. What could be the reason? We really do not know, but that's how it is. When you go to arts or commerce subject, there will be a lot of students in that. In fact, in our college, even now maybe the elections are usually won by a student who stands from the commerce department, because there are a lot of people to vote for him. The number is much more there. When it comes to science, if commerce is 1500, science will be 300. I mean, to that proportion or ratio. When it comes to mathematics, it will be 40 or 50. When it comes to real philosophy, if it is taught there, it will be in single digits. Like that is the structure. Now, why is it so? That we may not be able to understand, but the fact is it is like that. You take any other structure also, the structure of the society in which there are thinkers, there are people who are warriors, what we traditionally call as the Varna system, or you take the structure of an organization, a workshop or a factory, where you will find at the top the chairman is one, and the chairman or managing director, then there are couple of general managers, and then below them are the other managers. Then you have the supervisors who will be, let's say, much more. And then when it comes to the factory workers, it will be in hundreds or thousands. Like that it is. It will never happen that the decision-making authority who is sitting in the chair of managing director, they will be around 100 people and there are 3 people working in the factory. It will not work. It will not be like that. Now, why it is like that? Who put the structure like this? We really do not know. You take the case of animal kingdom also. Animal and plant, the nature put together. the amount of grass that is there all over the world is phenomenal. One third of the area of land is grasslands. That much of grass is there. Grass and other vegetations are also there. And the animals which feed on that grass, that will be definitely much lesser in number. And those animals which are carnivorous, which feed on these herbivorous animals, they will be much lesser in number. It will never happen that there are 100 lions and there are only 3 cows there in the or deers or something like that. That structure will not sustain itself. Now, the structure that is given for us, is it the best structure? We can say we do not know, but you have to then have the intellect to even try and make a system or a structure which is superior to this. Try to even attempt of something. See, we have got 5 senses. There are 5 elements in the world. These 5 senses beautifully correspond to the 5 elements. It's a beautiful pattern, coordination and synchronization that is there. Ear corresponds to space, eyes correspond to light, tongue corresponds to water, nose corresponds to earth, which is the the factor of smell, and skin corresponds to air, like that it is. Now, can you think of any other sense other than these 5 senses? Not possible. Even as we make certain inventions which are using human intellect, let us say you make a robo, that structure of a robo, why is it resembling a human being? Can you think of any other way by which it can be made? It can only follow what has been already there in nature, because probably that is the best. That is the best system, that is the best position that is for there. See, the eyes are there in the top of the, on the human body, right? Where else can it be placed? If you have to look ahead and far, it has to be at the top of the human structure, human body. The nose is here and the mouth is here. If you need to eat something, you bring it closer to your mouth. If it is not smelling properly, then you will not put it into your mouth. Once you put it into your mouth and goes inside, it is maybe it's going to cause problem. But imagine if the nose is placed somewhere else and mouth is placed somewhere else, how can this coordination happen? So whoever has structured this face like this, he has done definitely a phenomenal job. Like that it is, if you go into each and every intricate details, everything is very beautifully put, very well orchestrated, and it is for our benefit. So, whether the proportion of the gas that is there in as oxygen and nitrogen that is there in the atmosphere, whether the proportion of salt water and the fresh water that is available for us in the earth, whether there are other creatures and that are available, and along with it we are supposed to coexist in whatever population that we are, each and everything is very beautifully orchestrated and put. And in this, if we are able to have and develop this awareness, only then we visualize this grand coexistence. There is a melody, there is an orchestra. In orchestra, everybody has to play their part. There is but one person who conducts the whole orchestra. If each and every person is attuned to that one person who is conducting the orchestra, it will be a very beautiful music there. If one person does not fall in alignment with that, then that person is probably going to disturb the whole orchestra. He will disturb to that extent that he is influential. It is possible. And in this whole scheme of things of the universe, who is the person who can disturb this coexistence, mutual beautiful coexistence, is the human being. There is individuality, there is ego for all creatures. From the lowest microorganism, which can be a virus or a bacteria or an amoeba, to the fish or reptile or birds or animals and plants and grass, everything has a individualized ego. And human beings also have this ego. Ego is a separate existence which calls itself as I, which points out to something unique about itself. That is called as ego. But when it comes to all other creatures apart from human beings, they don't have this choice or luxury to assert their ego to such an extent that they fall apart from the nature. That is not possible for them. Only a human being has this ego to assert himself to say that I am different from all. As we say, that sense of existence separately is there for all, but to assert it to such an extent, to have an exaggerated opinion of oneself, that only a human being does. That is why in the 16th chapter, when Lord Krishna talks about divine qualities, he says, Na Atimanita. Atimanita means not much pride or not much ego. That means when you are saying, I am going, I am coming, when you are referring to yourself as I, that is there for everybody, that's okay. That's okay in the sense that's understandable. But that you put special emphasis on this and you try to show how superior you are, try to show how knowledgeable you are, or how that arrogance, when it is going to get itself expressed like that, that is what is causing all the disturbance. So it is the ego that forms a barrier between you and the world. Conversely, put it that way, a person who has conquered ego, a person who has annihilated his ego, he merges with the nature very beautifully. He lives a very harmonious life. He is called as technically a rishi. A rishi is one who has merged himself into nature. Like every other creature, they cannot live apart from the laws of nature. Like that, he has merged himself into nature by annihilating his ego. He is a rishi. Now, when this ego vehemently asserts itself, it is constantly craving for attention. Ego, that I am referring to myself, I need special attention. I need catering. I need catering from the people around, from everybody around, maybe, that my body, my mind, my intellect, they have to be catered to. Once the catering happens, it slowly boosts my ego further. And then I feel more and more superior about myself. And what I experience there is what is technically known as a superiority complex. This ego is something that needs to be constantly fed, and when it is fed, it is gaining that superiority and it feels superior to others. We discussed about the superiority in the very first class itself, in the Turkey and the Ant also, that inherent immortal self that you are, that is falsely projected on this ego, and you want to make it feel more and more superior. And that bubble is now growing, and that bubble is seeing all other bubbles around it, and it is feeling that it is superior to all the bubbles around that. That is called as a superiority complex. When that feeding of that ego is not there, when the ego is stopped, when it is craving attention and it is probably not getting, it feels low. Therefore, it feels what is opposite of superiority, which is called as inferiority complex. Inferiority complex is to feel extremely low about yourself. I am nothing, I am a bacteria, I can't do anything. This sort of a feeling that I feel inside me, that is called as a inferiority complex. What is interesting to notice, that both superiority complex and inferiority complex are function of your ego. In both the cases, it's function of your ego. In fact, there is no comparison between these two. Both needs to be tackled, and you need to get out of any complex for that matter. But of these two, inferiority complex is definitely worse. If a person asserts that I am everything, I can do everything, this is all me, that is superiority complex. When a person says I cannot do and everything, he goes into even a mode of inaction. I mean, in the sense that tamas is worse than rajas, in that mapping you can put this way. So, it is, remember this, that the world cannot give you any more value than what you place for yourself. This is a law. Whatever you really think of yourself, that is what maximum the world can ascribe value to you. That or little less, but not more than that. See, in other words, if you consider yourself to be a pigeon, you can fly only to that extent you feel you will be a pigeon. If you consider yourself as a sparrow, you can fly only to that extent you consider yourself as a sparrow. You do not definitely, there is no comparison with the eagle and these birds at all. Exactly like that, when you consider yourself, let us say, like an accountant or a supervisor or a clerk, then you can be maximum a better clerk or a worse clerk, a good clerk or a bad clerk. But that's all. Your level is at the level of a clerk. You cannot think, let us say, like a managing director. That is the value you set for yourself. Then others can maximum think of you like that only. They cannot ascribe any value that more than what you ascribe for yourself. And that is why Vedanta hammers into our head again and again and again that you are the self, you are the self, you are the self, you are infinite. Why don't you place that infinite value upon yourself? See, all other creatures, their life is programmed and their set pattern of thinking is there and it is all limited. They cannot go here or there. In a way that is good, but there is no sense of a conscious evolution. But a human being is blessed with tremendous potential. It is, even if you are there at the level of a sparrow, you need not just confine yourself to the level of the sparrow for the rest of your life. You can definitely graduate yourself to the level of a pigeon or an eagle also. That is possible. That capacity only a human being has got, and that is a blessing, we should say. So this thought process to take you towards that infinity is the essential purpose or message of Vedanta. Till that point, obviously, we are at various degrees of our evolution. In fact, this is the message that one of the ways that Krishna tells Arjuna is that Uddharet Atmanatmanam Natmanam Avasadet. Let man raise himself by himself. Let him not lower himself. Never should you lower yourself. Never should you feel low about yourself. Here is a fine distinction between an inferiority complex and what is known as humility. Humility and inferiority complex may sometimes look alike. They may express themselves alike. But there is a world of difference. World of difference means they are diametrically opposite. Humility is a virtue. Humility is a value and humility is knowledge. Humility is the other side of knowledge. Knowledge and humility go together. Inferiority complex, on the other hand, is extremely, what to say, ignorance. What is the difference? As I said, when you are feeling inferior or when you are feeling superior, here the discussion is not superior, when you feel inferior, the emphasis is on ego. To say that I am low, I am nothing, I cannot do, I cannot speak English, or I don't know poetry or whatever it is. Whatever you feel low about yourself, a very depressed feeling, that is the sort of essential quality of inferiority complex. And in front of somebody else, you automatically, you know, that type of feeling naturally comes. On the other hand, humility is that awareness of totality, which is knowledge. That is why in the qualities of Jnani, in 13th chapter, Krishna talks about first Amanitvam. Amanitvam is humility. So in the face of totality, in the vast expanse of totality, when you are standing aghast in front of that, what happens is that your individuality automatically sinks into insignificance. The head automatically bows down. The ego definitely surrenders there, and that is called as humility. So in humility, you are shifting the focus from individuality to totality, so that the individuality goes into insignificance. So that is a very grand state, as it were. But this person, as far as the individuality is concerned, he becomes very, very humble. That is why the Bhakti Yoga, which is 12th chapter of Gita, is placed after the Vishwarupa Darshana Yoga, which is 11th chapter in the cosmic form. in front of that cosmic vision, what happens to Arjuna is that automatically he stands aghast and he feels so small, small in the sense of he understands the totality. So automatically his head bows down, and in that stage of surrender, what happens is bhakti, or the essence of bhakti is the 12th chapter follows the 11th chapter. This is the difference that we need to understand. It is not with reference to how it expresses itself. It is what you feel internally. That is where the complex arises. And this may not be scope of the poem here, but one more thing about this complexes is that superiority complex sometimes expresses itself as false humility. And inferiority complex expresses itself as false superiority. This is very interesting. This is a psychology for you to understand even as you deal with people. There was a person who wrote Ishavasya Upanishad commentary and presented it to Swamiji. Swamiji, for his comment, for his opinion, for his endorsement or whatever it is, his word, blessing, whatever you can say. And Swamiji said, if you have written, go ahead, publish. I mean, it's all God's work. Like that, he tried to, sidetrack the issue. But he was insistent that he needs to comment and he needs to read and comment and say something. The undertone or the psychology here is, this person is telling Swamiji, I have written a book on Ishavasya Upanishad, you please, because you are giving Gita lectures, you are giving Upanishad commentary, look, I am also like you. You know, this is what he is trying to say. Though he will not say like that, and in the form of extreme humility and other things, that is what he wants to present himself as. And Swamiji said, when he read the preface, he says the preface is written in very small letters and the font is very small, yet it ran to pages. And the first sentence of the preface is that I do not wish to make this preface very long, and it runs to pages. And the preface is about everything. I am nobody to write the commentary. I am nothing. I don't know anything. Whatever mistake I write, it's all me. It is more about me, 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 like that it is. And of course, the long and short of it is, Swamiji blasted him and said that what audacity he has to comment on Upanishad when Upanishads are products of masters who have dissolved their ego and it is coming through them. But the point in this example is that he shows his extreme humility in front of Swamiji, like that it appears, but actually he is feeling superior that he has written a commentary on Upanishad. On the other hand, you will sometimes feel some people, for whatever reason, see, there is no need to feel anything about not knowing a subject or not being able to speak in Sanskrit or English or any language for that matter. But if he feels that way, that is unfair. So in a group of people like that, he will call other people names. He will put others down. Why he puts others down is an interesting psychology for you to understand, that he puts other people down. He may use an abusive word or a vulgar word in terms of a very friendly teasing, but you can very well make out that he is putting you down for him to feel superior. Why should he feel superior? Because he is internally feeling inferior. That is how it expresses itself. And what value you set for yourself, ultimately you only know, others will not know. This complexes come only because of our comparison with others, which is the root cause of all evil. Why should you compare yourself with others? Each and every person is unique. Each and every person is blessed with certain talent. See, it is another thing that in front of a sunlight, tube light may not shine. That is fine. In front of a tube light or sodium vapor lamp, a candle may not show. That is fine. But the candle need not feel inferior. The tube light need not feel superior. It is the feeling. It is, of course, that some person is talented with more knowledge, some person is talented with more artistic skills, some person is talented with more physical strength. That's what it is. But each and every person need not feel inferior or superior in front of others, but most of the people in the world, majority of the people in the world, suffer from complexes. The pendulum swings this way or this way. From one end to the other end, it goes inferiority or superiority. And also relatively, in front of some other person who feels who is very great, he thinks he feels inferior. In front of some other people, he may feel superior. Like that it is. But in both cases, some complex or the other is always catching a person. This poem addresses this issue very simply and very, what to say, in a very easy language, in a very easy narrative. We'll just go through this poem. The mountain and the squirrel had a quarrel, and the former called the latter little prig. It's good that the poet Ralph Waldo Emerson, incidentally, is a very great American poet, essayist, and I mean, I'm not sure, but probably Swami, even during Swami Ramatirtha's time, he quotes Thoreau and Emerson, and these are great thinkers who have been influenced by Bhagavad Gita also. It's so, therefore, there is definitely, you know, pearls of wisdom in whatever must be there in whatever they have written. Here the poet uses the term quarrel. Quarrel means not a fight. Quarrel happens amongst known people, relatives, husband and wife. This is generally called as a quarrel. So what it means is that there is some sort of a misunderstanding. So that means the setup is that the mountain squirrel, that is, they are the two characters in the poem, but there is a generally a coexistence, but that's some sort of a tussle that has happened between them, and they have a quarrel and they are probably talking to each other and calling other names. The mountain is calling the squirrel as little prig. Little prig is some haughty fellow who thinks too much of himself, something like that. So the squirrel, what squirrel says is the rest of the poem. That is giving a message to the mountain. Bun replied, "You are doubtless very big." So first of all, I appreciate and understand you to be a very big person. You have a mighty structure. But all sorts of things and weather must be taken in together to make up a year and a sphere. You are very big, but you alone cannot make up everything. That's not possible. That coexistence must have a squirrel also, must have a mountain also. Of course, these two are there, but you need to have everything. To make up a year and a sphere. See, sphere, I mean, in general, you take the universe, you take the world also. In world means everything has to be there to present the world as it is. There must be desert, there must be a mountain, there must be ocean, there must be river. There is grassland, there is forest, everything. All this is what is going to make up a sphere. Sphere of the earth I am talking about. There cannot be only mountains, there cannot be only plains, there cannot be only cities, like that it is. Similarly, year means all six seasons, or in England, four seasons, all has to be there. Only summer cannot be there, or only winter cannot be there. So, each and everything has a place. And who has done it, we do not know. That is where, see, everything has a place. Somebody... we talked about this in the gunas also. Sattva, Rajas and Tamas are three qualities, and there is a gradation of these qualities. But you cannot say, why is there Tamas in the world? Tamas also has a place in this world. Ocean has also a place in this world, and a fresh water like a river also has a place in this world. You are not to decide which is right and which is wrong. And so, everything must be taken in together. That means it is saying you must have the vision of totality. Only then you will understand that everything is put in the place properly. So, all sorts of things and weather must be taken in together to make up a year and a sphere. This is again very important. I think it no disgrace to occupy my place. You will not think it is a disgrace only when you are free from complex. Otherwise, a sweeper who is sweeping the road, that job, does he consider it to be a disgrace? No, he is doing actually a wonderful job of providing cleanliness and sanitation and hygiene. Like that it is. Like that, but a person of a chief minister caliber, maybe he has to sit in an air conditioned room, or a managing director has to sit there and do. He should be provided with that environment for his type of work. This person has to do his work in a hot sun, working in the factory, maybe working near a furnace, like that it is. In terms of their work, there will be something which is subtle and something which is gross. That is there, definitely. But the question is whether you feel superior or inferior. And therefore, no one need to think it disgrace to occupy, because these are in Ishavasya we studied this. Shashvatibhyah samabhyah, each and every duty has been allotted for eternal years. Who has allotted? We do not know, but it has been allotted. So why should you be feeling something disgraceful if you are going to feel in terms of that you are doing the duty which has been allotted to you? So the squirrel says, and I think it no disgrace to occupy my place. If I am not so large as you, you are not so small as I, and half and not half so spry. Spry means a very active thing. The mountain is very big and it is also you are big. So what is the big deal? If you are big, I am small, and you are not even active like me. There's a story about these five fingers. They are quarreling with each other as to who is superior, and each and every finger gives a quality or a characteristic about itself to feel superior. The thumb says that it is the most important thing, without which nothing can be done, and the thumb feels superior about it. Like that, the index finger, the middle finger says, I am the tallest. The ring finger says, I am the gold is worn in my finger, so I am the most valuable finger. Like that it is. So the small finger, little finger, what can it say? I am small, can it say? So it says all that is fine. But when the person prays to God, it is I who stand first. Like that it says. So like that it is. Each and everything that has a place, that has a purpose, like that it is. So the squirrel is telling mountain, okay, you are very big, definitely there. And I accept and acknowledge your bigness also, but I am small, yes. And half, and not half so spry, you are a static mountain, you cannot move here and there. I will not deny you make a very pretty squirrel track. So from squirrel's narration, we can see that the squirrel is very, very observant and has that awareness about the utility of other things here. And that is what is exactly what we need to do. There is a place for everything and everyone, and we need to acknowledge and be aware of it. Only then you will be able to understand your place also. So in orchestra, there is a singer, there is a person who plays drums, there is a person who plays violin or veena or guitar or any flute. So if you are aware that each and every instrument is required and they are playing, and the focus of every person is not on the instrument or what he is playing, the focus is on the person who is conducting this orchestra, the composer. And who is that who is making all this function? We do not know. That mysterious providence which makes everything function is attributed as God. I will not deny you make a very pretty squirrel track. Talents differ. Last three lines you have to by heart. It's given in italics. This is the essential message. Talents differ. All is well and wisely put. If I cannot carry forests on my back, neither can you crack a nut. Each and every person's talents differ. And what is interesting, all is well and wisely put. This is what we emphasized in the beginning, that there is a beautiful structure which you do not know why, but that has been put like that for a purpose. And there cannot be a better design like this. A person who sees a pumpkin which is growing in a small creeper feels that why has God made like this? And then he is sleeping under a banyan tree where a small fruit falls on him when the wind is blowing. And then he wakes up and he thinks for a moment, if the big fruit like pumpkin was there in this tree, what would have happened to him? So then he understands why the design is like that, why the nature is like that. So this is the essential message here. Talents differ, all is well and wisely put. If I cannot carry forests on my back, neither can you crack a nut. So what is it that we learn here? In this orchestra, there is a beautiful coexistence. If you are able to dissolve your ego, fall in line with the nature, then you will be supplementing and complementing each other. A beautiful melody, rhythm or song will come out of it. It will be a classical living. If you try to assert your ego, don't think that you will be dominating the orchestra. It will cause a disharmony for some time, but eventually you will be thrown out of the orchestra. Like that only it will happen. The orchestra is too big for you to handle by yourself. It will not happen like that. So therefore, there is no other way for us except to understand this harmonious existence, and move in such a way that we break the walls of ego and merge with the totality. We will listen to Swamiji's commentary here.
The universe is a composite whole of the animate and the inanimate. Both have distinct roles to play to sustain the world. None more or less important. They serve as spokes in a wheel. God acts as a hub holding them all together. Emerson proclaims this truth. None is superior or inferior to another in the perfectly designed universe. Yet people suffer from complexes of either superiority or inferiority. You must rise above complexes. Dissolve your ego. Just play your role in life to the best of your ability. That leads you to perfection.
Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.